which makes living beings possible, and where forms of matter known as dextrogyres and levogyres play an essential role. These are tiny, tiny creatures produce micro intervals perceiving at one end and acting at the other. And similarly, Deleuze identified what he called a gaseous perception in the films of Diego Berto, in American experimental cinema, and in video, in artworks that films that do not connect movements together but privilege the energy of lots of independent freely moving particles. He says they attain a pure perception as it is in things or in matter, to the point to which molecular interactions extend. And this reminds me of an intriguing statement by the American rational pragmatist philosopher Charles Sanders Peirce. Seen from the outside, a thing appears as matter. Seen from the inside, it appears as experience. So, back to Elena Del Rio, the film theorist, speaking of the melodramas of Douglas Sirk. While the narrative is taking place on a molar level, and it's trying to convince us into ideologies about the importance of a well-organized ethical family, of loyalty, of good business practices. On the molecular level, in Written on the Wind, a completely different kind of energy is taking place. Del Rio describes the bad girl character Mary Lee in Douglas Sirk's Written on the Wind. She's sexually voracious and frustrated. She's called a tramp. She wears hot colors. She's always bubbling with swishy gestures. She loves music. She loves to dance, and she's a good dancer. Mary Lee, Elena Del Rio points out, is a mass of molecular energy that cannot be contained by the molar morality of the film's plot. Now, if anybody remembers Written on the Wind, Douglas Sirk suggests through montage that Mary Lee's wild dancing causes the heart attack of the father, who you see fall down the stairs. So Del Rio is arguing that representation is molar, whereas performance is molecular. Representation represents, it's stuck with the precedent. Performance creates something new, becoming. So Mary Lee, I'm saying, is like a carpet, alive with an energy that bursts the bounds of representation. Another film theorist, Sergei Eisenstein, also observed a cleave between molar and molecular perspectives in painting. Eisenstein was interested in how montage can crash together different perspectives, producing something entirely new. And he saw this in Cubist paintings, and he also saw it in the 16th century painting of El Greco, who he called one of the forefathers of film montage, because El Greco's paintings have multiple perspective points that create a sense of simultaneous place in painting. So in this enunciation, you see how the composition tips and tilts. It's not offering the scene to one privileged viewing position as in Renaissance perspective, but it's rather inflecting at certain points, cutting into the visual field to pull selected elements into view. So certain parts of the image bulge out toward us and others remain hidden. And you get a sense in El Greco's painting that not everything is available to vision, but rather there's a struggle to make things perceptible, to unfold the world of perception. El Greco's painting exemplified how the universe consists of an infinite field of folds. So here you might hear an echo of liveness. So the tips of these poles look to us like points, but if you take one and drag it out, you will unfold a section of the universe. And you see how some of it in this painting, you see how some of the universe remains unfolded, like that vague area behind the dove representing the Holy Spirit, the squashed together mass of angel musicians, and the deep folds of Mary's robe. This this idea of the folded universe reminds me of something that Mario Carniola writes. The world is not empty. It's very, very full. So full that everything has to be folded up to fit. So, all these points that I've been talking about, are they disconnected or are they the seemingly disconnected surface of the substance that is actually internally connected? It really depends on what you believe, as I argue, in fullness and infinity. But Deleuze, writing on Leibniz, argues the latter, that all matter and spirit are inseparable. And I don't know what to do when that light goes off. All matter and spirit are inseparable, two sides of one fabric, deeply enfolded. The outside of the fabric is matter, the inside is spirit, Leibniz says. Deleuze invokes a kind of Leibnizian vitalism, a molecular conception of matter, or what seems to be matter, that has souls folded inside it. And in what follows, as you will know if you've read the folds, Deleuze describes a number of folds in the universe, of which one, the monad, contains the entire universe from its limited perspective. The monad is a kind of dependent universe. This view finds its complement in Islamic Neoplatonism, and in my book I speculate a little bit on the actual causal historical relationship between Islamic Neoplatonism and Leibniz's thought. Islamic Neoplatonism argues that all entities emanate from God, and you sense that both in Islamic Neoplatonism and in the thought of Leibniz, this folded universe is a very beautiful universe. It's beautiful to think that every soul reflects the whole universe from its point of view, but you sense that it's closed in on itself, and that nothing is free, really free, in this universe except for God. God even foreordains the amplitude of the soul, in Leibniz's beautiful phrase, which means whether the soul is going to be saved or damned. So we encounter in religious thought and in Leibniz a universe that is not really free because it's subject to the freedom of God. So Luke tries to liberate the universe from God by undoing Leibniz's ultimate dualism between soul and matter, organic and inorganic, by arguing that anything, not just organic beings, anything can individuate and can therefore enclose a vital soul-like force within it. So anything can be alive. An independent life force, he argues, courses through every individual. I'm going to skip over a little discussion of Deleuze and Leibniz's debt to Ibn Sina. So I think it's really important. And speaking of the inclusion of the humanities and that we should recognize the debt of the humanities to Islamic thought. So I've just taken as long as I say that I'm reading about this. I'll just say that a little bit of light reading in the medieval philosophy shows that Duns Scotus read Ibn Sina, and that Deleuze, when he quotes Duns Scotus, is actually quoting Ibn Sina. Okay, the fold, in short, suggests that a point has a kind of intensive perception free from any anthropomorphic perspective. And furthermore, it attributes a capacity to be alive to non-organic things, like rocks and atoms and carbon, as well as organic entities. So we get a sense that the universe appears as a series of disconnected points, but they are all connected by poles. And if we can relinquish the human point of view for a while, we can enter into the perception of these points and perceive the universe the way a point, a molecule, or an atom might perceive it. Okay, now something about algorithmicity. Now, carpets are an algorithmic medium in a very, very simple way. They're organized on a warp and weft, give them an algorithm as an instruction to be executed, unless it's a free-form carpet, you know, some, you know, folk and peasant carpets are. It is carried out, it's not a carpet, by the way. Good one. A carpet is made on the basis of an algorithm. And algorithmic processes begin at a point and unfold. And use in a carpet like this star Ushakat carpet, you can see algorithms of recursion, of mirroring, and other things that we need to know how to write a computer algorithm for. However, this carpet here, like many carpets woven for a court or for a rich patron, borrow their designs from other media. That's why I have this frontispiece from the Quran here. The carpet that we're looking at owes its design to something that comes from another medium, and it's carrying out an algorithm that's somewhat independent of the medium of warp and weft and yarn and threads per inch. So carpets don't only express the qualities of their material. They express a relationship between material and idea, or between material and algorithm. We can say further, the carpets and the things that are like carpets are indexes of their algorithms. And thinking in an unfolding way, we can say further that those algorithms index their weavers, their designers, their programmers. So when we look at a carpet, we see the expression of the instructions for their making, which is a communication between the designer and the weaver. The film scholar Braxton Soderman argues that we should analyze the qualities of programs, computer programs, as expressive and meaningful, as well as ideological. Algorithms are created by humans, of course, and so far from being called impersonal medium, the algorithm and algorithmic works like carpets indicate all kinds of decision-making, reflection, even emotion, and of course, error. This is a carpet from the collection of Joseph McMullen, made a fantastic collection to donate to the Metropolitan Museum. And he writes about this carpet, quote, "This is a very close but hilarious descendant of another carpet in the collection that's a little bit better. The design is basically faithful, but there is no comparison between the sloppy drawing in this rug and the sophistication of its model. While the use or misuse of color, particularly blue in the central medallion, is strange indeed, without system or sense." That's true. Again, green is used in the corn pieces at one end only. "It is all a refreshing reminder," Ms. Mullen writes, "that the human spirit can and does produce wonderful effects impossible to the trained and sophisticated mind." So I think this is really great, but I would like to see the warmth and humanness of algorithmic media, not only when they make mistakes, but also when they do things well.